federal government promises to explore Nigeria's human and material endowments to build a strong economy. The executive and the legislative arms of government partner to raise Nigeria's business environment. Plus, President Buhari thanks Nigerians for their good wishes and prayers, says there is no cause for alarm. Welcome to NTN Network News with me, Muhammad Kudu Abubakar. President Muhammadu Buhari has expressed his thanks to Nigerians, millions of Nigerians, over their good wishes and prayers in various mosques and churches across the country. In a parley with State House correspondents, Special Advisor on Media and Publicity, Femi Adesina, said President Buhari reassures Nigerians that there is no cause for worry as he is only staying longer than originally planned for his normal annual checkup on medical advice.
He is the one who owns the body, is his body, and there's nobody who will know his body more than him, and it is no cause for worry. The statement transmitted to me is that the president needs to rest for some further time. Let us learn to believe our leaders. This was a man we elected into office, and he says no cause to worry, let's believe him.
President Buhari's special advisor on media and publicity, Femi Adesina, there. Nigeria is adjudged to be endowed with numerous human and material resources, which has remained untapped. Acting President Yemi Osinbajo says the federal government will explore these resources to build a nation that has a productive, strong, vibrant, and sustainable economy that will meet the needs of the people. The acting president stated this at the 16th National Productivity Day Celebration and Conferment Award in Abuja. State House correspondent Jide Onifade has the report.
The 15 recipients of this National Productivity Order of Merit Award were said to possess sterling qualities of diligence, reliability, and creativity. Amongst them, and perhaps the youngest, is Saratu Azi, whose demonstration of honesty and prudent management has helped save the local government sector of Plateau State enormous resources. Acting President Yemi Osinbajo says it is a new dawn in the Nigerian public and private sectors, stressing the relevance of such values to national development.
Recognition and rewarding of merit and high performance is crucial for the advancement of society. Unfortunately, sometimes the Nigerian elite, which is charged with responsibility by a sheer force of privilege, has abdicated that responsibility. So today, the political and religious elite sometimes promote ethnicity and religion over merit and high performance.
Acting President emphasized on the Made in Nigeria drive of the federal government.
As the president said in the 2017 budget speech, we must grow what we eat, and we must use what we make. Nigerian resources and talent must be directed at producing what it is that we will eat and what it is that we will use. The sheer amounts of money that we spend importing everything and anything is one of those things responsible for our present economic predicament. Nigeria has the men, resources, and creativity to do great things locally.
So today, we have honored those who the country believes are doing well, showing good example in terms of what productivity means.
While commending the selection process, Acting President Osinbajo advised that future selection should expand to individuals, especially youth, who are making mark in agriculture. Five organizations were also honored and commended by the acting president for keeping faith with the country, even in recession. This award is in recognition of a new vision of promoting Nigeria and Nigerians wherever they may be. From the Nikon Luxury Hotel in Abuja, Jide Onifade, NTN News.
Still on the 16th National Productivity Day and Celebrations Award, hard work, dedication, innovation, and promotion of healthy rivalry at the workplace are among the criteria for selection of the recipients of the National Productivity Order of Merit Award. Recipients of the 16th edition include those who bought into the economic diversification agenda of the federal government in areas of agriculture and solid minerals development. Labour correspondent Emmanuel Aimiro has details.
From 1963, different modalities had been worked out for instituting productivity consciousness in the nation's system towards improving the economy. Since then, those who have contributed to the growth and development of the country have been honored among the recipients of the 16th edition of the National Productivity Order of Merit Award is the Vice Chancellor, University of Maiduguri, Professor Ibrahim Abaka Jodi, who, in the face of grave threats posed by insurgents in the Northeast, did not close down the institution.
We have weathered the storm out of the insurgency, telling the people that with the right mindset, with the right will, you'll be able to overcome.
Manufacturers using local raw materials, pharmaceutical industry, and agricultural commodities-based organizations were recognized for contributing to the diversification of the Nigeria's economy.
The farm alone, I think we have close to 3,000 workers, and we have an AgroWars scheme.
Guest speaker Ado Kejin, Minister of Mines and Steel Development, Kaode Fayemi, spoke on the theme of the day, productivity for sustainable entrepreneurship and employment.
We can only make progress and be productive when we stop celebrating criminals and brigands and start recognizing unsung heroes within our society.
People who are silently performing in the areas the government is focusing on diversification need to be recognized and rewarded to serve as encouragement for others.
Only 15 individuals and 5 organizations were honored out of 1,978 nominees. Emmanuel Ayemiro, NTA News.
Nigeria's profile as a country with an enabling environment for business may soon rise to the top of the ladder with obvious improvement in relationship between the executive and the leadership of the National Assembly. In a joint Presidential Enabling Business Environment Council meeting at the Presidential Villa, both arms declared that they are working for a healthy business environment. CDAS correspondent Jide Onifade has the report.
Acting President Yemi Osinbajo explains that the council has been working on issues of legislation germane to the ease of doing business, which explains the reason for the expanded meeting.
We are, you know, trying to improve the business environment in three broad respects. One is the entry and exit of goods, the entry and exit of persons into Nigeria, and then general government transparency, the transparency and efficiency in government agencies and parastatals, and of course, you know, the whole idea of ensuring that we're able to provide an environment for those who want to do business in Nigeria.
The acting president said a shortest possible timeline has been set towards achieving an improved business environment. Describing the involvement of the legislature as a good initiative, Senate President Bukola Saraki says it is a strong message to both local and foreign investors.
There's some laws that we have to pass in order to improve the business environment, and I think meeting together with the executive, working together, will make that work much easier. We have been doing things both in the House and the Senate and the executive, but today we're now coming together to look at areas by which we can share those responsibilities.
The Presidential Enabling Business Environment Council was inaugurated by President Muhammadu Buhari to chart a new course for doing business in the country. The council is chaired by the acting president. In the State House, Jide Onifade, NTA News.
Nigeria's Senate Tuesday adjourned plenary shortly after resuming from 3 weeks break over the death of House of Representatives lawmaker late Bellosani from Katsina State. National Assembly correspondent Waziru Zeyanu has details of these and other activities at the Senate.
After the usual resumption banters, Senate President Bukola Saraki read President Muhammadu Buhari's letter requesting for an extension of his vacation.
I'm therefore notifying the distinguished Senate that I'm extending my leave when the doctors are satisfied that certain factors are ruled out.
He also read Acting President Yemi Osinbajo's letter on the additional nomination of Adeyinka Aseku as non-career ambassador designate and that of the confirmation of Justice Walter Onogen as Chief Justice of Nigeria.
Following the recommendation of the National Judicial Council, I hereby notify you of the appointment of Honorable Justice Walter Samuel Nkanu Onogen, CFR, as Chief Justice of Nigeria.
The Senate President also announced the defection of Senator Andy Uba from PDP to the APC.
Mr. President, by this communication, I declare I am now a card-carrying member of the All Progressive Congress, committed to working with you and your party on the way we unite, build our policies, and take the vision of our party to our great country.
It will be recalled that Andy Uba had first declared his defection at a news conference in his country home in Ugwa, Agwata local government area of Anambra State, where he said APC had ideology and focus which he needed to tap into to provide quality representation to his constituents. Senate Minority Leader Godswill Akpabio immediately reacted on behalf of the PDP caucus through a point of order.
I would like to just save notice to the chambers that, again, that position belongs to the PDP, and it was PDP that contested the election in Anambra State, and what the save notice of our intention to go to court to reclaim that seat.
Senate Leader Ahmed Lawal then moved for adjournment in honor of Honorable Bello Sani, APC member, House of Representatives, who died at the age of 51. Outside plenary, Senate had criticized the inadequate appropriation of funds to the Nigerian Navy. Chairman Senate Committee on Navy, Senator Issa Miso, made the assertion when the Chief of Naval Staff appeared before the committee to defend the 2017 budget proposal for the Navy.
You have to make your work known, because you can't be working and hiding what you're doing.
Similarly, Chairman Senate Committee on Poverty, Alleviation and Social Welfare, Senator Ali Wakili, has reiterated that any agency that fails to present accurate facts and statistics in its budget defense will be rejected. He stated this at the 2017 budget defense by some establishments under the purview of his committee.
You talk about procurements. You didn't mention these procurements. You talk about consultants. You didn't tell us what these consultants are for. You talk about the World Bank. This is our driving, our nation's driving program.
Meanwhile, the various committees are expected to start submitting reports to the Committee on Appropriation, which will lead to subsequent stages that will culminate in the consideration and passage of the appropriation bill at plenary. From the National Assembly, Waziri Zeyanu, NTA News.
The House of Representatives also adjourned Tuesday's plenary in honor of late Bello Sani Maishi, who died Wednesday last week. He represented Dutsenma Maishi Federal Constituency of Katsina State. A cross-section of members described his death as a big loss to the House of Representatives. National Assembly correspondent Ignatius Onko reports.
Upon resumption from the 3 weeks plenary break, Speaker Yakubu Dogara announced the death of one of their colleagues, Representative Sani Bello Maishi, who died during the break.
And as is the custom of the House, we shelve today's business.
Prayers were offered for the repose of the soul of the late member, as members described him as a gentle and committed representative.
It was so sad. Actually, say we lost a very good friend, a brother, a colleague.
That will feel so bad, because he's a nice man, he's a gentleman, he's a man of his words, he's a trustworthy man.
He was a member of the 7th Assembly and now the 8th Assembly. And when you lose a colleague, it's not something you just forget like that.
The House observed a minute silence in his honor. Also a minute silence in honor of the late mother of Representative Abdulrazak Namdas and the fathers of Representative Ali Issa Jesse and Muhammad Saad Nabun Kari. Meanwhile, the Industrial Training Fund says out of the approved budget of 34.7 billion naira for training in the 2016 budget, 25.8 billion was released, which represents 74.34% implementation. The Director General of the agency, Joseph Ari, made this known while defending its 2017 budget before the House of Representatives Committee on Industry.
So under that reimbursement for the year 2016, the ITF paid back 6,352,656,183.
The achievements recorded in the reimbursement for 2016
far outweigh the achievements recorded in the training fund receipt.
The agency explained that it achieved 53.3% of its 2016 capital allocation from the National Assembly. Ignatius Nkwo, NTA News.
Information and Culture Minister Lai Mohammed says the greatest threat against foreclosing the activities of insurgency in the country is the proliferation of fake news. The minister stated this at the 7th edition of the National Security Seminar under the auspices of the Alumni Association of the National Defense College in Abuja. Anthony Folsom reports.
Having traveled to the Northeast a couple of times, the Information and Culture Minister is at a vantage position to speak on the armed forces' gallantry in the fight against insurgents. But the emerging threat, he said, must be contained in good time.
These stories that they fabricate are stories that are capable of setting one group against the other or one religion against the other. And regrettably, these fake news warriors, they have no boundaries. They operate worldwide because they use the social media.
Minister of Defense Mansour Deng Ali, represented by the Permanent Secretary in the Ministry, commended the Alumni Association of the National Defense College for initiating the seminar series as a platform to collaborate with the Office of the National Security Advisor to assess the state of security in the country.
This is more so that the lectures have been packaged to address the issue of terrorism from both military and human security perspectives.
On his part, Chairman of the Alumni Association of the National Defense College and his counterpart from the National Institute for Policy and Strategic Studies, KURU, said their role will always remain advisory to the federal government. With security as the main thrust of the assembly, Kogi State Governor Yahya Bello said the seminar has come handy on account of the fact that his state is being infiltrated by fleeing insurgents.
I'm happy the way the armed forces are executing their job. Kogi State is a wrong place for all criminals to hide, because I, in conjunction with all security agencies, will fight them and root them out.
The Alumni Association of the National Defense College was established in 2001 to promote social, intellectual, as well as professional interaction among its members and the society at large. In Abuja, Anthony Forson, NTA News.
The current state of insurgency in most member states of the Lake Chad Basin Commission require a dynamic, multifaceted security approach. Nigeria's Chief of Defense Staff, General Abayomi Olonisakin, stated this at a conference of heads of security agencies from the Lake Chad Basin member countries holding in Abuja. Defense correspondent Ismail Musa has details.
This is an assembly of ministers of defense, defense chiefs, heads of security agencies and intelligence services of Lake Chad Basin Commission member states and Benin, which was reorganized in 2012 with an expanded mandate of securing member nations through a combined multinational formation. The meeting will discuss general security situation in member nations, particularly the spillover arising from the destruction of Boko Haram main camp in Sambisa Forest, develop new strategy and intelligence network to hinder the regrouping of the dislodged terrorists.
I'm happy to note the successes achieved by the multinational joint force in Operation Gamma IT1. I was quite confident that Operation Gamma IT2, which have just commenced, will achieve even greater successes by dealing a decisive blow on Boko Haram terrorists in a collective area of responsibility.
Though the Joint Military Task Force says it has successfully destroyed Boko Haram camps along the borders of member nations and restored cross-border movement, the force reiterates its determination to ensure the resettlement of all displaced.
What we're doing is to look for new strategies to ensure that we really get over them by removing the remaining vestiges of their capabilities in whatever form.
The expert forum is preparatory to the meeting of councils of ministers and chief of defense staffs. Ismail Musa, NTA News.
More Nigerians are responding to the Nigeria Police Force's clarion call for support to secure the country for development by fighting crimes to a zero level. One of such is a donation of utility vehicles by a corporate citizen received by the Inspector General of Police, Ibrahim Idris. Edino Justice has the report.
Police foremost duty is the protection of lives and properties by being proactive in prevention and detection of crimes. Logistics plays a vital role in the attainment of these ideals. IGP Ibrahim Idris said the 5 operational vehicles from the concerned private citizen will go a long way to help the police in fighting crime.
I feel this is a very big gesture from a very good citizen of this country who want to assist the police in our ability to move around, in our ability to respond to incidents all over the country. If we can get this kind of response from good citizens of this country, police obviously will be properly equipped to perform its duties effectively and efficiently.
We have been training members of the armed forces and police as a special force to tackle the insurgency in this country.
IGP urged other corporate bodies and individuals to emulate the good gesture, as policing the country is everybody's duty. Edino Justice, NTA News.
Disaster risk governance at the national, regional, and global levels has been identified as pivotal for prevention, mitigation, preparedness, response, rehabilitation, and recovery towards ensuring disaster risk reduction. This was the focus of deliberations at the National Platform for Disaster Risk Reduction held in Abuja. Olajide Bello reports.
The Sendai Framework for Disaster Risk Reduction 2015 to 2030 is the first major agreement of the post-2015 development agenda, with 7 targets and 4 priorities as endorsed by the United Nations General Assembly following the 2015 Third United Nations World Conference on Disaster Risk Reduction. The framework is a 15-year voluntary non-binding agreement which recognizes that the state has the primary role to reduce disaster risk, but that responsibility should be shared with other key players, including the local government and the private sector. This informed the National Platform for Disaster Risk Reduction to serve as an avenue to brainstorm on ways to strengthen the National Platform for Disaster Risk Reduction in Nigeria.
At the national level, the country instituted the National Platform for Disaster Risk Reduction as a nationally led multi-stakeholder forum on disaster risk reduction in 2010.
The National Assembly is amending the National Emergency Management Act. So it is a good opportunity for the stakeholders also to submit their recommendations on areas where they want the National Assembly to quickly intervene.
One of the 7 global targets of the Sendai Framework is to substantially reduce global disasters mortality by 2030. Aiming to lower average per 100,000 global mortality rate in the decade 2020 to 2030. In Abuja, Olajide Bello, NTA News.
With me to discuss this Sendai Framework more in the studio is Alhassan Nuhu, Director, Risk Reduction, National Emergency Management Agency. Alhassan Nuhu, welcome to this NTA Network News Studio.
Thank you very much.
Tell us more about the Sendai Framework that formed the basis of your discussions by NEMA and the UNDP.
Well, the framework is a non-binding commitment of nations to substantially reduce the disaster risk by 2030. It has one expected goal. It has one expected outcome, one goal, 7 targets and 4 priority areas.
What are they?
The expected outcome is to substantially reduce disaster risks and losses in lives, in livelihoods, in health, and also to reduce socio-economic, political, social, cultural losses in individuals, in communities, and in countries. And the expected goal is to reduce, to prevent new risk and to reduce existing risk. And the targets actually is one, to reduce mortality, that if disaster comes, it should go without people losing their lives, to reduce the number of persons affected, to reduce damage, economic damage, and to reduce damage to infrastructure, critical infrastructure, health, education, water resources. And then five is to increase the number of countries that have strategies for implementing disaster risk reduction. And five is to increase cooperation between developed and developing countries in stemming up strategies to reduce disaster risk. And five is to have a robust multi-hazard early warning system. And the priority for action to achieve this, you need to pursue four fundamental actions. Pillar one is to understand the risk. What hazards are staring at you? What are the associated risk? You have to identify the risk and to assess it.
Has NEMA done that?
Yes.
How?
By carrying out vulnerability capacity assessment, by undertaking baseline studies, and a number of activities. And two, you have to strengthen disaster risk governance to be able to manage disaster risk. And three, to invest in disaster risk reduction so as to build the resilience of communities. And four, to strengthen disaster preparedness so that you can respond effectively and efficiently, and then you'll be able to build back better in rehabilitation, in reconstruction, and in recovery.
The disaster risk management is said to have certain challenges. One of them is the shortfall in infrastructure. In just 1 minute, how can NEMA, having identified this shortfall in infrastructure in Nigeria, achieve this disaster risk management?
It's actually to follow the Sendai framework by carrying out the four pillars. By investing in infrastructure, by strengthening the risk governance to have a coherence between the three tiers of government, and also by properly understanding the risks that stare at us.
Thank you so very much, Marlon Nuhu, the Director of Disaster Risk Management Reduction of National Emergency Management Agency. Thank you for coming to our studio.
Thank you very much.
Still to come, you can watch this news live online via the NTA mobile app, which you can download on your Android device at the Google Play Store or at the Apple Store if you use devices with iOS. More on the news, former President Goodluck Jonathan moves to resolve leadership crisis in the People's Democratic Party. These and more after this break.
From what we have seen, we have the capacity which we can rapidly develop or feed in ourselves. If we don't import rice, we stop importing corn and other grains, Nigeria would have plenty of money to invest into developing industries, especially manufacturing, textiles and so on, and develop iron and steel, and complement the infrastructure development. So really, the opportunities are virtually limitless, and we are very, very aware of this, and we are prepared to exploit it to the fullest.
You can make your laughter louder. You don't have to be fair. to make your presence felt. No matter where you are, we can be together in love. Together in love. Together in love. Happiness is sure. Let your joy be more. So everywhere you go, you can make your laughter loud. To make your presence felt. No matter where you are, we can be together in love. Together in love. No matter where you live. Together in love. No matter where you are. Together in love.
Mommy, more. Where would I be without you?
Should be Mother's Day. Show your mum love in the Picadumo way. Prepare a special meal with Peak Milk. Peak, reach for your peak.
Hello?
Welcome to the M6 Challenge. Using your new Geely M6, carry out everything on that list, starting now.
With a 5,000 milliamp battery that lets you go on for 2 days on a single charge. Geely M6, always in power.
Our river says, don't reach you 50 years.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
The Awards and Honors Subcommittee of the River State Golden Jubilee Committee is pleased to invite the public to nominate worthy individuals and organizations who merit recognition or have distinguished themselves or contributed immensely to the creation, growth, and development of River State. Nominations are welcome in all areas of human endeavors. Nominations should be submitted in a sealed envelope addressed to the Chairman, Awards and Honors Subcommittee, River State Golden Jubilee Committee, number 20, Apara Roads, GRA Phase 2, Port Hackett. Nominations can also be emailed to riversawards2017@gmail.com. All nominations shall include the name, address, phone number, and resume of nominee, as well as statement showing why the nominee should receive an award or be honored. Deadline for submission of nominations is March 5th, 2017. This is signed by Dr. Abie Sekibo, Chairman, Awards and Honor Subcommittee.
Your Indomitables pack is now 50 naira only. Nothing tastes like my Indomie. Now 50 naira only for Indomitables pack.
Indomie noodles, tasty nutrition, good for you.
The Future Assured Project and its components, Get Involved, initiated by the wife of the president, Her Excellency Aisha Muhammadu Buhari, is not relenting in championing the cause of Nigerian women and children. Its provision of free medical screening, educational support, and the fight against malnutrition, especially in the Northeast, has indeed informed international recognition, partnerships, and awards.
We are very grateful and appreciative for your wonderful gesture you have afforded to us.
With Future Assured, Nigerian women and children are assured of a bright future.
Future is assured when we join hands to promote the health of our women and children. Get involved.
Get involved and support the Future Assured initiative. Future Assured, promoting and protecting the lives of Nigerian women and children.
Following the approval of the whistleblowers policy by the Federal Executive Council and its launch by the Minister of Finance, Mrs. Kemi Adeosun, patriotic Nigerians have been making inquiries on how and where they could deliver information that could lead to the stopping or uncovering of fraud to the appropriate authority and answers to frequently asked questions. The Federal Minister of Finance has therefore dedicated a telephone line for receiving SMS, a whistleblowers portal, and an email address through which members of the public who volunteer to disclose information about a possible misconduct or violation could deliver such information for the attention of the team dedicated to process such information.
Thank you for remaining with NTN Network News. Former President Goodluck Jonathan has expressed willingness to wade into the leadership crisis facing the People's Democratic Party, PDP, possibly using the out-of-court settlement. This was the thrust of discussions at the former president when he met separately with members of the former Ministers Forum and Senator Ali Modu Sharif. Political correspondent Abdullahi Garbabendankudu has details.
Briefing journalists after 2 hours of closed-door meeting with the former president, chairman of the forum, Kabir Tanimu Turaki, said consultations are on to resolve the issues at stake. He expressed optimism that internal mechanism of the party will be applied.
You can see we've just started. We will meet with any person or group that is genuinely interested in solving this problem and moving the party forward.
Earlier, the previous day, PDP chairman Ali Modu Sharif visited the former president and discussed the situation in the party.
Father of the party, I will unite everybody. I'll make sure that everybody gets what he wants in PDP.
PDP is not factionalized, we are one. And as party leaders, we must make sure that we resolve our differences. There are always differences in politics. We cannot run away from that.
The case on the leadership crisis of the PDP is now heading to Supreme Court. In Abuja, Abdullahi Garba Burnunkudu, NTA News.
Governor Kashim Shettima has presented an uninterrupted power supply equipment to NTA Maiduguri Zonal Network Center to enhance its operations. The governor also approved funds for perimeter fencing and logistics for the NTA Network Center. Mohamed Goni reports.
Governor Kashim Shettima said the two sets of UFS equipment were presented to the NTA to enhance its services, and that government insisted on the best quality in spite of the cost, which runs to 17 million naira. He assured of continuous support to the NTA Maiduguri Zonal Network Center, saying the organization has always stood by the people of Borno in their trying moment. The governor also informs the management of the NTA that he has approved 29 million naira for the fencing of the premises of the Maiduguri Zonal Network Center and also donated bus to staff, which was also presented by the deputy governor, Usman Mohamed Drukwa.
We'll also make deliberate efforts to give you more adverse placements. We'll make efforts to support you in terms of logistics. We have become one family.
Zonal Director Maiduguri Zonal Network Center, Lawan Umar Lalu, appreciated the governor for the continued support to the NTA.
After installation of this thing, when we start transmission by 6 a.m. in the morning, will not close till 12 midnight. And even if there is NEPA, which is why we need the UPS, we are going to make it 24 hours.
Senior Special Assistant to Governor Kashim Shettima on television, Kwab Chibata, said the NTA deserves the support considering the continued contribution to fees building in Borno. In Maiduguri, Mahmoud Goni, NTA News.
Former Director General of NEMASA in court in Lagos. Vera Chumewa is on our Lagos Network Center with more on that story. Hello, Vera, over to you.
Good evening and a warm welcome to Lagos. The Federal High Court Lagos has begun trial to test the voluntariness of statements obtained from the former Acting Director General of NEMASA, Haruna Jaro, facing 304.1 million naira charge fraud preferred against him by the EFCC. Also today, the court ordered another former Acting Director General of NEMASA, Kalisi Sobi, to enter his defense in the case of 136 million naira fraud against him. Justice Mojisola Olaterego gave the ruling in a no-cut submission filed by the accused.
Former Acting Director General of NEMASA, Haruna Jaro, is standing trial alongside Dauda Bawa and Thumbuwa Enterprises on 19-count charge bordering on the offense. The court had admitted them to bail in the sum of 5 million naira with two sureties in like sum. the first prosecution witness, Oji Chukwuma, had testified before the court how several sums of monies were converted by the accused. EFCC counsel Rotimi Oyedepo has sought to tender the written statements of the accused as evidence, but this was objected to by the defense counsel, Olaleke Ojo, who argued that the statements were not voluntarily obtained. Ojo had urged the court to order trial within trial to ascertain if the statements were voluntarily obtained by the EFCC. When trial within trial began today, a videotape was played in the open court with the aid of a projector showing how the statement of the accused was endorsed by Akeem Lasisi, an EFCC operative. After the video, which lasted for about 35 minutes, the defense counsel observed that the recording disclosed no date, commencement, and termination. The witness told the court that he personally recorded the endorsed process. Also today, Justice Mojisola Olatorego, in her ruling, said there is a prima facie evidence against the former acting director general of NIMASA, Callistus Obi, and Alu Dimas in the 136 million naira fraud charge preferred against them by the EFCC. Counsels to the accused, Wale Akoni and Joseph Ngobiku, had filed a no-case submission, urging the court to hold that the prosecution had not made out a prima facie case to secure conviction of the accused. EFCC counsel Rotimi Oyedepo had urged the court to have a glimpse of the totality of the evidence adduced by the prosecution before arriving at a conclusion whether same can secure a conviction. Justice Olatorego has ordered the accused to enter their defense.
If you're just joining us, you're watching the NTA Network News, reaching you live from the Lagos Network Center. We have more reports ahead on the news from Abuja when we return after this time out. Don't go away.
I encourage my kids to learn new things, and if they get hurt, I rely on the power of my Dettol's one capful. To fight germs, it's like my own first aid kit.
My family needs protection from germs. I use the power of Dettol's one capful to disinfect surfaces and clothes to keep them clean and safe from germs.
I trust the power of Dettol's one capful for bathing. The power of Dettol's one capful protects from up to 100 illness-causing germs.
Millions of powerful Niger moms use the power of Dettol's one capful to protect their families. Be a powerful Niger mom with Dettol. Be 100% sure.
Nigerians. Suicide bombers are not spirits. They are not ghosts. They are human beings like you and me. They live amongst us. They are your neighbors. They are your friends today, but terrorists tomorrow. So you must know your neighbor now. Security begins with you and me. Know your neighbor. Be vigilant. Be security conscious. Report suspicious persons, objects, and movements to the police and other security agencies. The security of our nation is a duty for you and me.
If you see something, say something. Nigeria, unite against terrorism.
This message is brought to you by the Federal Ministry of Information and Culture.
Thank you for remaining with NTA Network News. Federal government solves $1.3 billion loan from China's Exim Bank for railway projects. Details with Vivian Idekpefo on Business News.
A very warm welcome to the Business News segment. The Minister of Finance, Kemi Adeosun, says Nigeria intends to borrow at least $1 billion from the World Bank. Speaking with CNBC Africa in Lagos, the minister added that the government hopes to sign another $1.3 billion loan from China's Export-Import Bank to fund railway projects.
You see, we have a deep domestic capital market, and that's always got to be tapped first. And then you supplement it with money from the external market. I think the acceptance of our Eurobond shows that there is appetite for Nigeria. So I don't have any concerns with our ability to raise money in the external capital markets.
Mrs. Kemi Adeosun adds that there is no need for a loan from the International Monetary Fund, IMF. Meanwhile, the Central Bank of Nigeria has announced a special wholesale intervention forward, not exceeding 60 days. This is sequel to its revised forex policy released February 20th. Consequently, the Apex Bank will not apply all the provisions of Clause 2.4.3 of the revised guidelines for the operations of the Nigerian interbank foreign exchange market. As such, it has advised banks to ensure that their current accounts that are with the CBN are adequately funded on the day of bidding, failing which the bids will be disqualified. And stocks on the Nigerian equities market recorded a marginal gain of 0.01%. Its year-to-date returns, however, stand in the negative at 6.04%. Here is a snapshot of Tuesday's closing figures. And that's business news at this time. The rest of the bulletin continues.
₦465 billion has been distributed to the three tiers of government as revenue collected for the month of January. Permanent Secretary to the Ministry of Finance, Mahmoud Isa Dutse, announced this, who chaired the Federation Account Allocation Committee meeting, announced that distributed amount is ₦65 billion higher than what was shared in December 2016. Details with Leah Katunbabatunde.
The decision to curb output and reduce glut in the international market by the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries, OPEC, may have begun to yield positive results for Nigeria. The month of January saw an increase of $74.91 million in Federation export sales due to a rise in crude oil export volumes by 1.49 million barrels and an increase in the average price of crude from $47.3 per barrel to $49.57 per barrel. Permanent Secretary to the Ministry of Finance, Mahmoud Isa Dutse, says the positive returns is an affirmation that the nation's economic recovery is on course.
In figures to increase, and then the average price of oil also during the period was higher. So those are the two main reasons why the figures for this month are higher than last month.
We at Commissioners Forum, we have agreed to reduce our dependence on federal government by at least a minimum of 40% to 50% in the next 1 to 2 years.
Of the ₦465.146 billion distributed, ₦282.406 billion represents statutory revenue, ₦73.522 billion VAT, ₦48.371 billion exchange gain, and ₦60.85 billion excess petroleum profit tax. There was a refund of ₦6.33 billion by the NNPC to the federal government. In Abuja, Leketung Babatunde, NTA News.
The Nigerian National Petroleum Corporation, NNPC, has explained why the corporation owed ₦23.4 billion in respect of Nigeria Export Supervision Scheme fees chargeable on crude oil and gas exports since 2008. Speaking in Abuja before a Senate Joint Committee, Managing Director NNPC Capital, Godwin Okonkwo, stated that the National Assembly had always budgeted ₦20 million for NESS fees, adding that NNPC lacked any legal right to remit any amount above the appropriated sum once it was exhausted.
NNPC just houses the fund. And when the reconciliation is done and signed off, NNPC transfer the fund to CBN, who knows who has done the job, who the contractors are, and pays them accordingly.
Speaking at the occasion, Senate Majority Leader Senator Ahmed Lawan said the 8th Senate is committed to promoting transparency and accountability of all public and private institutions that transact business with or on behalf of the federal government. Farmers in Sokoto conclude registration under the Growth Enhancement Support Scheme. Details of these with Zainab Abdul Nasser, who is in our Sokoto Network Center. Hello, Zainab.
And welcome.
Farmers associations in Sokoto have called for total overhaul of registration process for the Growth Enhancement Support Scheme if the program is to achieve its objectives. This is coming as the program rounds up the registration of farmers in Sokoto for this year's cropping season. Mohammed Nasir completes the report.
Growth Enhancement Support Scheme is the federal government initiative aimed at subsidizing the cost of major agricultural inputs to farmers. Farmers registered under the scheme receives SMS alert on their mobile phones and then proceed to the nearest agro dealer to redeem the input with 50% value of the input price. In Sokoto State, 30 redemption centers have been opened for the revalidation and registration for new applicants who will benefit for this cropping season. A visit to one of the redemption centers by NTA News showed the revalidation exercise progressing steadily, but characterized with some issues that include underage registration and inducement of prospective farmers in order to turn up for revalidation.
Communicate with other states, Sokoto State are far left behind, which is very discouraging. So you encourage them by doing this.
State Director, Agricultural Transformation Agenda, Engineer Sule Abdelmajid said officials pay regular visit to redemption centers to monitor the exercise. Chairman of All Farmers Association of Nigeria, Sokoto State Chapter, Murtala Gagaru Minanata, identified some challenges that need to be addressed, which include technicalities in registration and selfish interests in registering farmers. An agro dealer under the scheme, Sani Alhaji Bilal Nahaja, also described the program as a morale booster to farmers. In Sokoto, Muhammad Nasir, NTA News.
Nigerians have been asked to complement the effort of the present administration to eradicate corruption in the country. The Minister for Youth and Sports, Barrister Solomon Dalong, made the call at the 6th annual Murier Talaka Awareness Initiative in Birnin Nkebi. Usman Abdullahi Shehu has more on the story.
Barrister Solomon Dalong said Nigerians have a lot to contribute towards President Muhammadu Buhari's effort to stamp out corruption in the country. The minister said it is the duty of Nigerians to report all corrupt activities around them. At the same time, avoid any corrupt practices, mismanagement of public resources, and abuse of power.
The organization will review the performance of government and offer advice where it is necessary.
Governor Abubakar Atiku Bagudu, represented by the Chief of Staff Alhaji Suleiman Muhammad Arugungu, commended Murier Talaka Initiative for the awareness on fight against corruption and other related vices. In his goodwill message, the Minister of Justice, Barrister Abubakar Malemi, represented by Dr. Haliru Bala, urged Nigerians to remain united with a single purpose to make the country great again. The guest speaker at the occasion, Alhaji Muhiyu Magaji, the chairman Kano State Anti-Corruption Agency, said it is corruption that put Nigeria in its position today, challenging Nigerians, especially youths, to stand up and fight it. Brennan Kebi, Suman Abdullah Heshehu, NTA News.
And that's it from here. It's back to you, Kudu.
You're watching NTA Network News. When we return after the break, we will bring you developments around the world, sports update, and the Wednesday's weather forecast. Stay with us.
The unending need for a roof over the heads of civil servants is the focus of NTA Tuesday Live this week. Talking of staff housing and schemes and other related issues only on Tuesday Live. It will be incisive, informative, and engaging. Don't miss it. Join us.
Your Indomitables pack is now 50 Naira only. Nothing tastes like my Indomie. Now 50 Naira only for Indomitables pack.
Indomie noodles, tasty nutrition, good for you.
The production, distribution and sale of counterfeit and fake drugs is a corrupt practice and a crime against humanity. This has informed several measures and strategies to combat fake drugs, including introduction of anti-counterfeiting cutting-edge technologies to detect fake drugs on the spot. These technologies are being deployed to all the states across the Federation, as well as the internally displaced people's camps. The President, Muhammadu Buhari, and his team are committed to this fight.
The federal government of Nigeria, in line with its anti-corruption agenda and posture, will fight a total war against fake drugs and other unwholesome regulated products in order to ensure that Nigerians remain healthy and well.
Lend your support and join NAFDAC to rid the country of fake drugs and unwholesome regulated products. NAFDAC, safeguarding the health of the nation.
So what's up, sweetheart? You really look like you're up to something.
I have a secret.
Okay.
I'll be going to Europe next week.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Like you have your visa, your passport, your plane ticket.
No, not that way. Some men are helping us. We pay them, they take us through the desert, and then we cross the sea into Europe.
The desert, the sea. Isn't that the route where many have died?
Yes, it is indeed a very dangerous journey. In 2016 alone, 4,900 people died while crossing the Mediterranean Sea to enter Europe. Many were Nigerians. For the very few who survived the journey, they are forced into prostitution or other crimes just to survive. Eventually, they will be arrested and deported to Nigeria. Don't be a victim. Don't go this way.
This is a public service announcement brought to you by NTA.
For major developments around the world, here's Chimdimba Ndibisi with Global Tidbits.
National Organization for Migration says 74 bodies were washed ashore near a western city in Tripoli, Libya. Officials believe the bodies are from a capsized boat that left Libya on Saturday with 110 people on board. The unidentified bodies will be buried in a cemetery in Tripoli. And ahead of planned Friday march against undocumented immigrants in South Africa by a group, 30 foreign-owned shops have been looted in two neighborhoods overnight. The unemployed rate in the country, which is at 25%, is seen as the reason for the rise in xenophobia. In the meantime, the European Union has voted to extend economic sanctions against President Robert Mugabe, his wife, and the defense industry. This comes as President Mugabe marks his 93rd birthday. From Australia comes a report that a light plane has crashed into the warehouse of a shopping mall in Melbourne, killing four United States citizens and an Australian. Many cars were also set ablaze by the fire from the crash site. That's Global Tidbits. Chimdimba Ndubisi, NTA News.
Kene Emawodike has the sports update.
Four matches will be played midweek in the rescheduled Week 7 matches of the Nigeria Professional Football League. Enugu Rangers will welcome Lobi Stars of Makurdi. Katsina United play against FC Ifeanyi Yoruba of Nnewi. Rivers United face Kano Pillars, while Shooting Stars travel to Bauchi to meet Wicked Tourists. As Nigeria's representatives in the CAF Champions League, Rivers United set to meet El Merrikh of Sudan in the next stage of the competition, the management of the club has attributed their victory against AS Real Bamako of Mali to excellent preparation, saying more work will be done to fortify the team. Following the successful week-long inaugural training for some future professional ladies golfers at the IBB International Golf and Country Club Abuja, organizers believe the country can produce six professionals annually in addition to the existing two. The coordinator of the inaugural training and professional lady golfer, Uloma Mbuko, who stated this, said the depth of professional ladies golfers will be history by 2020 if the program is sustained.
I'm of positive mind that we'll have at least five ladies that will make it through. So by next year, probably from December, we should be able to start counting more ladies from this program.
The International Olympic Committee is retesting thousands of samples from the Beijing 2008 and London 2012 Summer Games, as well as the Vancouver 2010 and Sochi Winter Olympics, in the bid to root out any doping offenders. The retesting of samples is to last another 5 years to 2022. With sports update, Kenen Imabudike, NTA News.
The burial of Major Abiodun Dohati, retired, has been fixed for Friday, the 24th of February. The late Abiodun Dohati died in October last year at the age of 72. He served in the various frontline positions during the Nigerian Civil War and was a military port commandant, Tincan Island Port, and port manager, Container Terminal Ijora, after retirement. Late Major Dohati also worked in the Nigeria Ports Authority, NPA, and rose to the position of acting managing director before retirement. He is survived by his wife, children, and great-grandchildren. That concludes Network News for tonight. Thank you for watching. Good night.
Ha 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 ha!